refining your personal brand for the next phase of your career. The great thing about a personal brand is that you are you. You are you no matter what. And no matter what it is that you do or what it is that you want to do, you are the only point of difference. Whatever you're trying to do, somebody else does it. So the real key is, with all this noise and with all these cluttered fields, how do you stand out in people's minds? How do you make an impression on somebody in a way that not only can get you the job you want, whether or not you have specific experience, and we'll get into that, but in a way that this is a powerful thing that you can take with you anywhere you go. This is actually my fourth career. So I have brought my sum total of experiences to a variety of places and pathways and positions. And so the key thing is that I am me. Okay, so first of all, and this was in the description when you signed up. So what is it that you do? Note, I didn't say what's your title. What is it that you do? Even if you've had several jobs, there's key things that make you unique. So we're going to talk about how to really put your best foot forward in that way. We're going to talk about how to define your personal story and what platforms to use. And we are, because we're talking about professional stuff here, we're really going to talk mostly about LinkedIn for purposes of this discussion. But I'll touch on the other platforms too. So, four main chunks we're going to cover here. One of them is, who are you and why should people care? Another is, what makes you stand out from the others who do what you do? Remember, you're the only unique part of your value proposition here. Who do you serve and how? You've got to get clear on that, because when it comes down to it, people aren't here for what you offer. People are here for what you offered them, for what they're going to get out of it. So we talk about how to make sure that we're clear on that so that we know what they need. And then how can they find you? That's where the social media part comes in. So first, who are you? Starts with, what do you do? But as I said before, that's not your title. What you do is not accountant. What you do is help people gain mastery and control over their finances. What you do is not photographer. What you do is help people capture and present themselves in the way they would like to be seen. Kind of marketing speak there, and you don't want to be too indirect. You don't want to fluff things up so that people can't figure out what the heck you do. But the fact is, you really want to go a step further. Your position and title is not what you do. What you do is what that looks like. What do you actually do? What do you accomplish? What value do you bring? To that end, what value do you bring to the table? What value do you bring to the table? That is your sum total of talents, skills, experiences, connections. That is you. What you bring to the table is not just a degree in this subject from this school. That is not what really makes you qualified. What really makes you qualified is what you bring specifically, because there are plenty of other people who majored in the same thing at the same university. There are plenty of other people who have very similar professional backgrounds to you. What have you gotten out of those experiences that you can bring to someone else? Whether you're bringing it to their company as an employee, or whether you're bringing it to their network as a connection. What are your personal brand values? This is something a lot of people don't give thought to. I encourage everyone to look up, and I should have had a link ready, but one of the most famous TED Talks is from someone named Simon Sinek, and it's What's Your Why, or Start With Why. I actually have his book, Start With Why, on my shelf right next to me here. And what that means is, you can't start with what you do and then figure out why the heck you do it. You have to start with, why do you do what you do? Why do you care? Why are you pursuing this line of work? Why have you applied your talent and experience to this? What is your why? Why are you in it? You don't have to say that part out loud necessarily, but it has to at least be underlying in everything you do. For example, my why is, I truly believe that small businesses are what make our communities great. I believe that they are not only what make our communities interesting and different from each other, so we're not so homogenized in this strip mall world, but I also believe that, you know, small businesses keep money in communities, which keep them thriving. So that is my why. My why is I want small businesses to continue to thrive and succeed in our local communities. In order to do that, I happen to have a set of skills that I can help them apply to that, that I can help them succeed. I can help small businesses not go out of business and get seen by the people who would actually support them and lift them up. So that's my why. My why is I love small businesses and I think they're important to our communities. So think about your why. What makes you want to do what you do? And that can be applied to even the driest of industries. One of my clients is a financial advisor who also sells life insurance. And her why is that, you know, she knows people and she is a person who has spent their life building a career, building a family, building all these things. She wants it to not go away. She wants to protect what she has. She wants to have choices in her future, and she wants her family to have choices in their future as well. So she wants to help people protect what they have and what matters to them and what they've spent their time and energy and heart building. So that's her why. She's selling insurance. She's a financial advisor. That's a little dry. She has a why. And so as long as that's underneath everything she puts out there and every interaction she has as part of her brand, she's got her why. So what are your personal brand values? Make sure that everything that you put out there about yourself, you don't have to straight out say, here's my brand values, but it has to at least be in there from your own point of view. Another thing about who are you? Will people remember if they've encountered you before? So this could be as simple as, if someone meets you at an in real life networking event and then they go look you up on LinkedIn, will they know that you're the same person? That doesn't just mean have a current picture. It also means if you talked to them about what you do and what you're interested in, and then they look at your LinkedIn profile and see what it says you do and you're interested in, do those pictures match up? If you are on LinkedIn, but you also have a professional Facebook business page, would someone encountering each of those digital properties know that they are the same? Because here's the deal. They say that it takes X many brand exposures for someone to make a purchasing decision, right? So first of all, you are a brand. So the same is true of you. It takes a bunch of different exposures to you and who you are before someone knows if they want to work with you, if they want to hire you, all of that. But those brand impressions need to compound upon each other. If someone sees you in one way and then they see you in another way and they don't make the connection that you are the same person, then those brand impressions are not compounding. It means that this element of you has one impression and this element of you has another impression, as opposed to you having two impressions. I hope it's a weird concept, but the fact is, have something, know what's special about you, know what's unique about you, and be able to speak clearly enough about who you are and what matters to you that people remember if they've met you, and that if people have encountered you either in real life or online, they know that you are the same person or brand that they have encountered before, so that it's a build. Okay, what makes you different? What do you bring that's often missing? So as I said, what you do is not unique. Look at the field that's out there. Look at other people who do what you do. Look at even other people's outsider impressions of your industry and of people in your industry. Look at what's the same. Figure out what makes you different. One little thing that's unique. For example, it doesn't have to be fully unique. You don't have to be the only person who has this. But for example, I work with a lot of realtors. Everyone knows a million realtors. There are so many realtors out there. I live in a very realtor heavy area. And one of the realtors I work with, she personally flips old houses. Like, that's her hobby. She and her husband flip old houses. So you know what? That's kind of interesting, because she, even though there are other realtors that do that, that's not what you think of a realtor as doing. And so the fact is, that means that anyone who is interested in renovating an old house knows that she's a good person to be working with and talking to, because she knows what is and isn't possible. So someone who is looking for a property like that is going to be able to tap into her expertise in that regard, because they know that that is a unique point of difference about her. So what do you bring to the table that is not something that people necessarily associate with your career, but that is something that can add value, and it can be specific kind of niche value. That is fine. Because here's another thing, people worry that by associating themselves with something specific, they won't be found by people who need something else that they offer. That is not true. People will always ask. I have made myself very clearly social media. I say social media everywhere. I get asked every single week if I can do someone's website or if I can write them a press release. I'm not a web developer. I'm not a public relations expert. Yet I get asked for these adjacent services. So people will always ask, don't worry about pigeonholing yourself. It doesn't mean you won't be found for other things. It means that you will definitely be found for the right things. Okay, moving to another point. What past experiences do you have that are relevant to today? This is what I talked about before a little bit, which is everything you've done has contributed to your skills, to your learning, to your perspective. It's all a matter of spinning that to show that relevance, to show those transferable skills, as I talked before in the open room. So even if you are just entering the workforce, you have no professional experience, you've never done an internship, you never even, you know, bussed tables at a restaurant, you've literally never worked. Were you involved in any student activities? Have you been involved in any community activities? I have a good friend who helped raise her 8 brothers and sisters. That may seem like something that is not professionally relevant, but it taught her about delegation. It taught her about management. It taught her about managing with compassion and, you know, increased her emotional intelligence. Really, almost anything, if you really try to look at it through that prism, if you look at the lessons and skills that you developed in whatever life experiences you have had, you can find that little angle to apply them to whatever it is you want to do going forward. Because when it comes down to it, your abilities matter more than your experience. It doesn't feel like it at the beginning when you're trying to get an entry-level position, but think about it. You only need one entry-level position. Kind of like, you know, if you're on a dating website, you really only need that one right person. So look at your experiences and how they can help you, how they can be applied to where you want to be going forward. What is your niche? I just touched on this a little early, but when it comes down to it, you want to have a point of difference. I was talking to somebody yesterday who is, again, a financial advisor, a different financial advisor. There are a lot of financial advisors out there. And she said that she especially loves working with female entrepreneurs because a lot of times small business owners, especially small business owners and especially women, sort of don't think about the saving for retirement element. Because when you work for a company, you kind of are automatically contributing to your 401k or whatever. Like there's something automatically built in that you can opt into. When you're running your own business, that doesn't exist for a lot of people. So she really likes helping small business owners, especially women, put that together for themselves, make sure they're saving for retirement. That's very specific. Can she help a 70-year-old man, like make sure his investments are in line? Of course she can. Is she still gonna get 70-year-old men inquiring about her services? Yes, she will. And she will still take some of them, but she won't get as many. She will mostly get female entrepreneurs contacting her because that is what she has identified herself as wanting. But that's not all she's gonna catch. Think of fishing with a net, like big commercial fishing operations. Do they only catch fish in their net? No, they catch old boots. They catch hypodermic needles. They catch all sorts of stuff. But the fact is they go to the part of the ocean where the fish are. So they're more likely to get fish if they go to the right spot. And yes, other stuff will happen into their net, but you want to make sure you're casting your net in the right spot. Can you tout any past victories? Again, this goes to, you can say all you want about, oh yeah, I learned leadership skills from, you know, doing this thing in, you know, my high school debate team. But did you win any debate tournaments? Because that's a victory you can tout. If you have professional experience, did, you know, you participate in some, did you contribute in some really clear and meaningful way to a huge win for your former employer? you know, tout that. Did you get any academic awards in college? You may not have work experience, but the fact is, if you performed really well at school, that is something you can tout. So any past wins along the way, no matter how small, as long as they are genuine, go ahead, put them on your LinkedIn. Maybe your resume, though. Nowadays, you know, you want your resume to be a little bit tight, but the fact is you can put that stuff out there. You can call yourself an award-winning whatever if you've actually won an award for whatever. Okay, moving on. Who do you serve? Not everybody. This goes back to the niching. If you serve everybody, you serve nobody. And the reason you really need to know who you serve is because you need to understand their needs. So, part one of that, not serving everybody. Who are you for and who are you not for? I am not for a huge corporation. I'm not going to come in and teach your chief marketing officer stuff about social media. If you have a chief marketing officer, you're probably not my clientele. I am not for people who want someone to do it for them because I don't do that. You have to define who you're not for in order to clearly define who you are for. And again, more people will slip in. More people will find you. More people will ask you if you will work with them. And it's up to you what you do with that or not. But you really do need to understand, in order to narrow it down and in order to be focused, you need to know what you're not focusing on. So have a clear understanding of who you are and who you serve and who you don't serve. Also, what can you do for them from their perspective? A lot of times we come at it from what we want to offer, or from what we want to get, or from what we want to be. And we're often using slightly different language than the people who are looking for us are using to look for what they're trying to find. So we need to think about, from their perspective, what are they looking for? What are their pain points? What are their problems? What are their needs? If you're looking for an employer, you know what you want to get from them. You know the type of job you want to get from them. You know what you want to be accepted for. What are they looking for? What are they looking for to fill that position? What are their needs? Really, it's such a subtle shift, and a lot of times we think that we're thinking about that, but when we actually look at the words that we're using in our heads and on our profiles, we are often actually going from a perspective of what we're trying to get at, putting our dreams out there. It's not a bad thing to put what you want out there, but you also have to think about it from the perspective of, what is the person who is looking for me looking for? Because that's really key. You need to make sure that that language and those desires and those priorities match up. Why are you the one that they need? So this is when it comes to, when you have the mindset of what are they looking for and how are they looking for it, you realize how you can present yourself as that. Because again, it's all about the spin. You don't want to present yourself as anything that you're not. Never lie when looking for a job. But the fact is, if they're looking for someone with excellent communication skills, you want to make sure that you know that you are putting forth your excellent communication skills and your experience with that. If you've won an award for writing, if you've been published in a publication, you want to make sure that that is findable and visible, so that your accomplishments can speak for you, but you want to make sure you know which ones are going to be valued by the people who need to find you. What information do you want them to have? What do you want them to know about you? What do you really want to stick in their heads about you? If you have 2 seconds with them, like people talk about the elevator pitch, which is how you express who you are and what you do in a brief elevator ride. If you find yourself in an elevator for just a couple floors with the person who could give you the opportunities that you want, how would you concisely put it? Think about that. What is the most important information to convey to your potential future employer or client? And what would make them contact you directly? What kind of information would they need to have to be like, oh, I got to stay in touch with this person? And then how do you want them to describe you to others? What are those really salient things that you want to stick out about you, where when they think of you, these are the words that they use? This is how they talk about you to others. Oh, I met this person today and they were XYZ. What do you want them to go back and say to the hiring manager if they've met you somewhere? How can they find you? Okay, think about demographics, interests, and needs, because that will determine where they are online. I think that all of you need to be on LinkedIn. Like, that is, if you're looking for a job, if you're working, any professional really does need to be on LinkedIn, no matter what profession you're in. I'm sorry, you do. But the fact is, do you need a Facebook business page? Do you need an Instagram business presence? Do you need to be participating in professional conversations on Twitter? Think about the demographics, which is, you know, age, sex, region, you know, where, you know, industry, all of that. Where do those people tend to hang out? Interests. Are there conversations of interest around a given topic happening on certain social media platforms, or are there not? You know, there's not a lot of accountant discussions going on Instagram. However, if you're in the food business, there's a ton of conversations going on Instagram. So it's about knowing where the conversations are that you need to be a part of. And needs. Again, what information do people need to see from you, and what platforms are the best places for conveying that? Networking events. Networking events are not dead, even in the time of COVID. They are happening on Zoom, but you need to know which ones are and aren't worth your time. And the only way to do that is by looking into them, and sometimes by going to them. But it is often worth it, especially nowadays, because the people who are showing up to networking events online tend to be kind of more in it to win it. You know, so they tend to be a little bit more interested in making those connections than they would if there were, you know, free wine and cheese involved. So choose where you're going to network, but make sure that, make sure that that event is not self-contained. Make sure it's the beginning of conversations. The networking event should be the middle, and you should spoke out. Make sure that every person you meet at that networking event, you follow up with somehow. You can add them on LinkedIn. You can send them an email saying, great to meet you at such and such event. Let's stay in touch. Make sure not to put that experience to waste. It's a pain in the butt to make that time to do that follow-up, but it is very much worth it. That is how you get value out of events. The value is not in the event itself. It's in the relationships that you grow out of it. I talked a little bit about this. LinkedIn is where people are to talk business. So, and it is certainly a place to be found for professional reasons. Twitter is a place for conversations and for communicating information. There are certain industries that have very active conversations happening on Twitter. There are certain industries that have Twitter chats around their industry. There are there's a lot of conversation on Twitter around conferences, if that's a thing in your industry. But that's not the case for everybody. Facebook is kind of the main street of the internet. So a lot of businesses do have a presence on Facebook. So that is a good place to be for a lot of places, but again, not all. You really need to assess how you're going to use that profile. Facebook's about starting conversations. If you're just putting promotional messages out there, Facebook, you're not going to get any traction on. You need to be there to start conversations. And if that's not something you and your business are prepared to do, do not go there. Instagram, again, Instagram really lends itself to things that are communicated visually. If you are part of or trying to get into a community and an industry that tends to be active on Instagram, then by all means, get into those conversations. Comment on those comment threads. Slide into the DMs. Get seen in that industry. It's very easy to get seen on Twitter and Instagram, especially, to get into those conversations that you want to be a part of. Niche. So there are kind of, depending on what you do, I know that in real estate, there are a few real estate specific networking platforms. There are chat boards, there are websites and blogs that you can get into conversations on. And then referrals. Don't just think about the industry that you want to be in. Think about surrounding industries, surrounding professionals, because the fact is, if you want to be, if you want to be a social media strategist, you can't just be talking to other social media strategists. You also have to be in conversations with small business owners. You have to be in conversation with other, you know, business coaches. You need to be around other people who can refer you to people who can say, oh, I was just in a conversation with somebody today who needs you. I'm going to zip through this very quickly because I really want to get to your questions. So branding best practices, use all options. This is having to do especially with profiles on any platform. Use all options at your disposal. You know, really fill out those profiles as completely as possible. Use up all your characters. On Instagram, use your hashtags. Really use every option because you're informing the algorithm. you know, about who should be finding you and why. Also this goes in real life too. Like, make sure you have a business card. Make sure your business card isn't boring, if at all possible. If you have a website, you know, make sure that that really conveys who you are. Use options at your disposal. Be recognizable so that the brand touches compound. Make sure that you are recognizable in every platform, whether it's every social media platform or even in real life. If someone's seen you online before and then they meet you at a networking event, they should know that you're the person they've seen online. What are you hoping to achieve and how will you recognize success? So online, here's a few goals that people have. Maybe they want to get direct business. Maybe they want to establish thought leadership. They want to be someone who people tap when they want an expert to talk about something. Maybe they just want a lot of followers on YouTube or a lot of connections on LinkedIn so that they're known as sort of someone with a lot of connections. Maybe they want to get further visibility opportunities for speaking. So know what you're going for. And above all, lead with value. Think about what you can bring to them, not what they can bring to you. Okay, I see that we definitely have stuff going on in the chat. Okay, so this is someone introducing themselves. Let's go down here. Sorry. Had to get a job through AMA. Okay, sorry. Any advice for career changers to marketing? And this was in the general group, but I'm gonna answer it anyway. Focusing on transferable skills. If you can market yourself, that's a big plus. Showing that you can market yourself is really the best way to do it. And your own story as to why you're making the change. Sure, again, start with why. Benefits to being an AMA member, I don't know. Yes, informational interviews with alums. That is very smart. That is always good. And that's a great way to leverage your network because they already have something in common with you that is something they value. You know, if I went to a certain college, I already think that someone else who went to that certain college, you know, I already feel an affinity for them. So yeah, work any network you've got. Okay, it's recording. Yes, Simon Sinek, start with why. Thank you so much, Jamie, for putting that in there. Review alerts. Yeah, absolutely. It's a good idea when you have notifications, look at that. Because if someone reaches out to you and you don't respond back, you're saying that you're not going to be a very valuable part of their network. If you don't have an online presence, you're not relevant. Yeah, that's true because people are going to look you up. People are going to look you up no matter what. You want to make sure that there's plenty for them to find because that speaks volumes. Elementary school teacher transitioning to higher ed part-time and getting ready for grad school. Tips for branding since you're in transition. Well, that's a very common thread, which is education. That is huge. Yeah, certainly talking about education and talking about your why of why you're making that shift. What is your passion that is leading you into higher education? That's certainly a good thing. And getting ready for grad school, you know, you are in transition there. So talk about the things you're excited to learn and talk about the things you did learn. You know, if you just learned something incredible, start conversations around it on LinkedIn. Show that you are learning, show that you are valuable, show that you are hungry for knowledge and that you're passionate about educating others as well. Because if you share what you just learned, that says something about you. Things or tactics to avoid or troublesome/counterproductive. I would say, don't be afraid to edit your network. I just had this conversation with someone this morning where they said they're hearing from people, oh, you need to accept everyone on LinkedIn. You need to, you know, join every group on Facebook you're invited to. You don't have to do anything. Your network is your own. It's up to you to figure out how much time and energy and what type of time and energy you want to put towards nurturing those relationships. And when it comes down to it, it is a lot more about the quality of relationships and the relevance of your network than it is about quantity. That said, leads can come from anywhere. Opportunities can come from anywhere. So just try to balance those in your own life. What parts of the LinkedIn profile? Yes. So first of all, your headline right under your name. Your headline defaults to your current job title and employer. Change that. It is not your title. It is what you do. Really make that more interesting. And then your about section, your summary, pack that. Pack that. It makes me weep when I see someone who has their tiny elevator pitch as their whole about section. Nope. That part is very keyword rich. You want to make sure to use that space as much as you can to tell who you are and what you bring to the table. Next three steps I'd recommend to start working on your personal brand. Again, focus on what you do, not your title. Focus on your why of what you do, because that makes people feel like you are more passionate and motivated and also gives them something human to warm up to. And then focus less on what you are putting out and more on how you're bringing value to other conversations as well, because the LinkedIn algorithm in particular actively notices the conversations you participate in, not just the ones that you start with your own content. So make sure that you are bringing value to relevant conversations. That'll put you in front of the right people. That'll give people the right strong impression of you. It'll also tell LinkedIn that you're someone who is worth putting in front of people. Recent grads, should you be more broad in positions you're open to, then focus on your niche after gaining experience. So here's the thing. With that, if you're open to different job experiences, so different applications of your why, that's fine. Focus on your why. Focus on your why, because the what you want to do can be a little broader to apply to numerous positions. So maybe your why is, I really love presenting brands to the people who they will resonate with. That could apply to a million different positions, but that's a why. So focus on your why and the skills that you bring to that position and the passion. And so that will help you be clearly branded while also open to different opportunities. Yes, the about section opens a lot. Photo frequency of change. Don't change your profile picture a lot. That should be your professional headshot. If you pack your about section, will that turn people off? No. No, you can still be punchy and long. It can be long and strong. Weldon raised his hand. Let me see. I'm not sure if I'm able to let you talk, but I would love it if you could ask your question right there. There you are. Can I let you talk? Weldon, can you try talking?
Hi, Christine.
Can you hear me? Yeah, I can hear you. Good.
Good. Great. Thank you. For anyone who's worked in brand management for a while, you understand that part of the brand identity is the reputation it has in the marketplace, not just the positioning that the owner creates for itself. What are your thoughts on approaching your fans, your detractors, for input on your personal brand statement and using the input, the information they give you to help you make this a realistic and perhaps broader? They may suggest things that you had not thought of. But do you have any ideas on how to approach people for feedback on creating your brand identity statement?
Absolutely. Again, a very famous marketer, and I forget who it was, said your brand is not what you say it is. Your brand is what other people say when you're not in the room. And so in order to know what that is, you have to know what other people are saying. So that's where social listening and engagement really come into play. And you need to not just be putting things out there. That's part of why engaging is really important. Engaging not only with the people who are engaging with the content that you have put out there, but also engaging in other places, putting yourself out there, going into the broader internet community and understanding that context. Because if you just stay siloed with, here's what I want to put out there, you're not going to know what's actually being received. You can put something out there, that doesn't mean it's the message that people are receiving on the other end. So it is very important to be aware of conversations that are out there. When those conversations are negative, that's when it becomes important to differentiate between what is a valuable opinion, which is this someone who is a potential client or is a potential employer? Is this someone whose impression of you actually could impact your life? Or is it just noise on the internet? So it's important to differentiate between those two, because not every piece of feedback is valuable feedback.
No, very true. And I'm thinking more of sort of face-to-face, one-on-one in your own office as opposed to the internet, just the people that you work with. You have fans and you have, well, detractors. It's just about how you live. So I just wondered how would you feel if someone approached you to give them feedback on their brand statement, what they stood for, how they work together? How would you like to be approached with a question like that?
Well, again, assess the value of their opinion to you. I would say always make people feel heard, because when people don't feel heard is when people get nasty. So make sure that people feel heard. They went to the trouble of telling you their thoughts. Make sure that they feel heard. And if you are seeking feedback, make sure that you are making it clear that they will be heard. And you're not just looking for somebody to pat you on the head and tell you you're doing great. So that's really what it is. And if they say something you totally disagree with, say, well, thank you for your feedback. I will keep that in mind. I hadn't been thinking of it from that direction. If it is something that could be of value to you, and especially if it's someone whose opinion is relevant to you and what you're trying to do, then, you know, let them know. You can echo back to them the parts that you found especially relevant so that they really understand that you have heard it. Reflective listening, repeating what they said back to them is very important there. What should you do on LinkedIn if you're transitioning to a new career? Focus on the transferable skills. Focus on the stuff that you developed and learned in your past career that is relevant to where you want to go, because you are still you, and making it clear that you are the value and your past experience makes you more well-rounded than people who have only done the thing you're trying to move into. How'd I come to use the color red as part of my brand? It's my favorite color. And it's easy to do. I have bad lighting today because it's kind of gray here today, but I have bright red at the end of my hair, though I'm phasing that out. I usually have bright red lipstick on. Everything is red. I just really like it. Oh, I like this. Okay. There's an article that Jacqueline recently published. I definitely want to check that out. And it is a power color. Yes. You can Google all sorts of things about the different messages that color actually gives us on a neurological level. I like getting people excited about social. So red is exciting. Red gets people pumped. And I'm able to back that up with my personality. If I were really kind of super professional and staid and boring, which is fine, because sometimes that establishes trust and sometimes that makes people feel like you're a trusted expert. So I'm not saying anything against boring brands. I'm saying me, given that my brand is such a personal brand, I need some wham pow. So that's that. I'm wondering if I should let everyone back into the main room now. I know people are leaving because the session is basically over. So I am going to go into the main room now.
Sorry, yes. Just 1 second.
Go for it.
We're going to give them 10 more minutes for questions.
Sure.
I actually did have a question. Mm-hmm. So how much time of your day would you say that you put into branding yourself?
I'm a very bad example because I love swimming in social media all day. I like to say that I kind of made my personal addiction into my profession. So I'm a bad example. But for most people, you can actually do this in not a whole lot of time each day because you can sort of be targeted with it. You can say, okay, these particular chunks of time each week, like maybe for half an hour on Monday and Wednesday and Friday, you take care of really doing that social listening, seeing what conversations you want to hop in on, seeing what conversations people have, you know, tagged you in, seeing what is out there. You can do that for chunks of time a few times a week, or you can do that for smaller chunks of time every day if you want to. It's more about staying fairly consistent. It's about making sure that you never go too long without checking in on your network and seeing what's going on with them, not just the messages that are coming into you. You do need to make sure to go out there and see what other people are doing as well that you can hop onto. Because, I mean, if you build it, they will not come. You need to make sure that you're also putting yourself out there. But it really can take, a really varied amount of time depending on what is worth it to you, what's enjoyable to you, and what's productive for you. And the only way to find that out is by doing. Your audience is not the same as anyone else's. I hope that helped. That was a little vague.
Yes, thank you. Appreciate it.
All right, so we are going to be hanging out a little bit more. So any more questions? Definitely hit me. Another thing about branding, by the way. I've been told I have a very strong brand and people know if something's from me. So figure out what some key components of your brand are. I go a little over the top with mine because, I mean, part of my brand is that I do branding. So I go a little over the top. You don't have to be quite as branded as I am. But the fact is, always consider when any piece of content goes out from you or when you're putting together any sort of profile anywhere, think about the key messages that you want people to have about you, the key impressions you want people to have of you, the key words that you want them to use when describing you, the key ways that you want to make them feel. Put everything through that lens. Even the words you choose when you're introducing yourself to someone at an event. Make sure that that all creates the same feeling, creates the same basic impression. So that again, those impressions compound upon each other. And the more clear every single piece of that puzzle is, the less work it will be eventually, because you know what it is. You know that little mental checklist that things need to go through before they go out as a message from you. And before long, it becomes very natural. It's like breathing, you know, it's very simple. It's like brushing your teeth, you know, it just becomes something that you do. And is it something you still have to be active in doing? Sure. But it's part of your routine. I hope that makes sense. How do I feel about heavily designed resumes? Formatting should remain simple and straightforward, because the more you jazz it up, you're exposing yourself to negative judgment. Yeah, you really have to bear it. That's where thinking of your audience comes in mind. If you are applying for a position as a graphic designer, your resume probably should look different than if you're applying as a corporate lawyer. So really think about what the person needs to see, because sometimes what the person needs to see, honestly, is that you know how to sort of toe the company line and you know how to be on brand for them. So it really look at the audience. Think about how the audience is going to receive what you're putting out there. But generally speaking, no matter what you're going for, the substance needs to matter more than the style. My color's been red for a long time, and I haven't applied for a job in many years, but last time I did, I had, you know, a couple printed out copies that had my name in red and the rest was black and just normal. But the fact is, my name was in the same font that I use for everything. And, you know, so I had that going for me. But beyond that, it was honestly pretty plain, because the fact is, I wanted people to read it. I wanted people to focus on the words. And that's really what it should be about. That doesn't mean show no personality. That doesn't mean use the default font and don't do anything interesting. But, you know, Google around a little bit. There are definitely good examples of resumes. And if you're going to get crazy with your resume, really bear in mind if that's the impression that is going to leave on the person it is going to, and if that is relevant to what you're trying to do or not. How to build on personal branding during an interview. Again, making it really clear that you're the same person. So if I were hiring somebody and I received their resume and I got a certain impression from the resume, I want to make sure that when I'm talking to them in person, it feels like it's the resume come to life in a way, as opposed to being like, do I have the right resume in my hand? I would have looked them up on LinkedIn and everything already too. So making sure that you still come across as you, and that your why also. You know, start with why. How do you deal with varying personalities when developing a personal brand? Culture difference between upstate New York and the Midwest, for sure. You don't always have to fit in. That is the main thing that I would say. Just as I said, who you're not for is as important as who you are for. People may have been turned off by your directness. I'm sure other people admired it. Just really look at, maybe it's a wrong fit for you. If you're a very direct person and that is one of your skills and you're in an environment where that is not valued, yes, there is such a thing as needing to develop certain skills. You might need to develop certain, you know, empathetic skills or certain communication skills so that people don't feel put off by your directness. But try to judge what's a matter of, I need to develop this other skill, and what's a matter of, this isn't an environment where my skills are as valued as they could be in other places. So try to determine what is a matter of, I need to develop skills in this other direction, versus what is a matter of, I need to take my skills in another direction. East Coast, woo, lifelong New Yorker here. But I could totally see that being an issue. I have a lot of friends in the UK, and the level of directness there is very different from a New York level. But, you know, for every person you turn off, you're going to get another admirer of your, and it's a matter of, again, figuring out what you need to work on versus will someone else find this to not be a flaw? Again, I mentioned online dating earlier, but it's kind of like love. I mean, there's people where they're going to see certain things of you as a negative, but the right partner for you will not. So same with jobs. It's a matter of, yes, there are sometimes things that you need to work on and develop in order to work well with others, but you need to look at maybe sometimes there's just not a cultural fit and you need to find some place that will value those skills. Entertaining in New York style. Yes, I understand that completely. All right. Anyone else? You've got me. And again, it's so funny. Anytime I talk to anyone about LinkedIn in particular, I feel all paranoid. I'm like, oh, now I have to fix my LinkedIn and make it better. It's a constant journey, constant journey. But yeah, definitely connect with me. I'm going to put in my info link again. Yes, there is a recording. I don't know how to access it. If our lovely hostess can tell us again, that would be great.
Yes, we'll be sharing the recording. You'll receive an email with the survey so you can give us some feedback, and also the recording so you can hear the entire conversation.
Yeah. Are there any social media tools I would recommend? For a long time, I was a tool hater. I was very into just managing things scrappy and real and all of that. And then I realized that, you know what, I can actually devote more time to engaging if I use tools to help me with getting my content out. So I use a scheduler for some things. I have a schedule. I use Agora Pulse, but that costs a lot. So Hootsuite is all a lot of people need. But a scheduler is great because you can batch create certain types of content. Like if there's certain things you want to promote over and over, or if there's certain like recurring content themes you want to put out there, you can batch create content. I love Canva also, which is a great free design tool that's online. So you can batch create stuff. You can put it into your scheduler. You can not worry about content for like 6 months if you're really on top of batch creating and scheduling. That can free up your time for engaging. So that is really key. Don't think that being able to set it and forget it means that you can just, you know, no. Anything you put out there, it needs to be the beginning of a conversation, not an end unto itself. So if you are going to use tools that make content creation or scheduling or social listening easier, make sure that you put that saved energy and effort into what really matters, which is personal engagement. Tweaks to bios and branding, considering the current state of affairs, totally up to you. Again, think about what's on brand for you. Think about what people are going to think. With me, since I'm a personal brand, a lot of my accounts really straddle the line between personal and professional. So it made sense for me to say a little something. I actually am going to be starting more messaging around supporting small businesses, not only in areas where there's been looting, but also especially Black-owned small businesses. So that is both on brand and personally meaningful to me to share how you can help communities that are being disproportionately affected by all that's going on.